Well, good morning and welcome. Thank you so much for choosing to join us this morning. My hope and prayer is that we can remember to magnify our Heavenly Father, to make Him greater and to make us less. Let's continue to glorify His holy name.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my doom till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my doom till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine. shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Awesome in power, our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. Then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand we'll be right back.
Good morning, and love to you all. Thank you for joining us here at Cornerstone Community Church. I'm Pastor Curtis, and this is officially my first Sunday with you as lead pastor. I want to thank God for this church, for you. I want to thank both Pastor Rick and Dawn for their 27 years of dedication and service to this church. I also want to thank God for giving us all that we need to live a godly life whenever we are around. This past week, a person commented to me, "What a time to decide to be a lead pastor." I responded with, "Well, I don't think anybody really decided anything about what's going on right now." Right now, we are in the midst of racial strife, biological strife, and economic strife. It would be remiss of me to say that aren't we also under spiritual strife, as if our spirits weren't affected by all the other things mentioned. But I can also say this confidently: God is not surprised by what is going on. God is also not afraid. And I know the gates of hell cannot put up a good enough fight to defeat Christ's church. There are many questions that we're all asking in all of this. And in this church, we have the added dynamic of transitioning leadership. One of the biggest questions that we're all asking right now, especially for here, is what in the world does our future look like? We're told in Scripture that we ought to have a ready answer for all of these sincere questions. In 1 Peter 3:15 to 16, it says this: "And if someone asks you about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it, but do this in a gentle and respectful way. Keep your conscience clear. Then if people speak against you, they will be ashamed when they see what a good life you live because you belong to Christ." In 2 Peter 3, we're also told this: "We are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, a world filled with God's righteousness. And so, dear friends, while you are waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that are pure and blameless in His sight." So what does the future look like? I hold on to the promise that God is going to make all things new. New heaven, new earth, no more pain, suffering, and death. I hold on to that hope. But I also realize this, throughout all of my studies so far, whenever I see the future talked about and God's promises, what is coupled with it is how we ought to live. The authors bring a therefore, and they turn the tables as if to say, yes, we have God's promises, but in light of those things, live upright and holy lives. It seems that the future events are to be an encouragement for our obedience, to live correctly and to live in God's freedom now, not to use God's grace and salvation for fire insurance for later, but to use God's salvation to transform our being now. It seems like the question of what does our future look like actually needs to be transformed to how is God supposed to transform my being so I can be prepared for whatever the future looks like. More simply put, who has God made me to be? And who has God made you to be? Most of us ask that question of who in the world has God made me to be? And along the way of life, we get subtle hints or maybe not so subtle turning points. But before we answer that question of who God made you and me, let's turn to 1 Samuel. A little background of this story is that there was a woman named Hannah. She was married to a man named Elkanah. She was unable to have children, but one of his other wives made fun of her that she was barren and couldn't have children. She would try and inflame her jealousy. And in fact, it made Hannah grief-stricken. She would often go to the tabernacle and pray. She was so overwhelmed with grief that the priest came over to her and asked that she would leave because she is drunk. That's what grief can do to us. It can make us act maybe unreasonable to the outside eye. But after Eli, the priest, understood that she was so grief-stricken, he asked, well, what is it that you're asking of the Lord? And she said, I want a child. I would want a son. And upon hearing this, Eli said, go and be blessed, and may God give you whatever it is that you're asking for. Later on, she was with child. She named her son Samuel. After Samuel was weaned, Hannah went to the tabernacle, and he was given as a servant of the tabernacle, that he might become a priest, that God would use him. And she did this to give God thanks. As we read, it says this. One night, Eli, who was almost blind by now, had gone to bed. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was sleeping in the tabernacle near the ark of God. Suddenly the Lord called out, Samuel! Yes, Samuel replied. What is it? And he got up and ran to Eli. Here I am. Did you call me? I didn't call you, Eli replied. Go back to bed. So he did. This happened two more times. Samuel had never gotten a message from the Lord before, and Eli finally realized that it was God who was calling the boy. So he said to Samuel, go and lie down again. And if someone calls, say, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went back to bed. And when Samuel did this, the Lord spoke to him and revealed what was going to happen to Eli and his family. Just like in the time of Samuel and Eli, most of us are in this time where we haven't heard God speaking and we haven't been receiving visions from the Lord. But I can also tell you this. When was the last time that you can remember that you quieted yourself before the Lord and waited enough time to listen for His voice and to hear from Him? How often have we quieted ourselves before the Lord to let Him speak? The first time I recall doing this was on a short-term missions trip when I was in Botswana. We had been serving the local villages, doing what we called hut-to-hut ministry, literally just asking if there was anything we could help with. We had also been going to schools doing HIV and AIDS talks, letting kids know that they needed to, if they were to engage in sex, to engage with protection or to abstain, knowing that sexual relations are best used in a marriage context. And so every night while we were over in Botswana, we would come together for prayer and for worship. And on this particular night, the team leader said, well, he asked, would those of you who feel called by God to enter into ministry and specifically for missions to stand up, that we would pray for you, that we would celebrate God's call in your life? And my first thought was, oh, cool, I get to be here while other people called by God get to be prayed for. And I sat there silently and I just had this thought of, okay, Lord, if I get to be here, that's really cool. I wonder if you have something for me. And for the first time in my life, I heard God say, stand up. My mind went racing a million miles an hour. Stand up. Those who were called to be missionaries or maybe ministry leaders are supposed to stand up. You're telling me to stand up? And it was like a death moment for me. It's like all of my life and my life plans were put before me, and I had a decision to make. Was I going to listen to the voice of God, or was I going to go follow after my own plans? And I just began weeping. For those of you that know me, that's probably not a shock to you. But for the first time in my life, I felt like God was speaking directly to me. And I can tell you that there were some pretty mature teenagers on that trip. A lot of them understood what was happening, and so they came around me and prayed for me. And that was the first time I ever heard somebody say, Lord, prepare him for this life of ministry. I came back from that trip a young teenager, knowing that God had drastically changed the trajectory of my life. Along the way, as I asked questions and I began seeking out wisdom and counsel, it seemed like God would reveal just little bits and pieces along the way as I became obedient to His call and was responsible for what was in front of me. And as we get to know each other more, as we traverse our times together, you'll hear more details about these stories. But for today, let it be sufficient for this conversation to say this: God has called me to be a pastor. God has called me to advocate for the often overlooked. God has called me to train leaders, to guide and take care of the church, and to guide and take care of the lost. If this is who God has made me in my being, know that what is done through me has been crafted by God's grace, His mercy, and calling in my life. What does the future look like? It looks like God's promises being fulfilled by people whose beings are being transformed, including me and including you. I ask you to quiet yourself before the Lord and ask, who has God made me to be? You will find these guiding posts in your life, those subtle markers or those very obvious turning points. God is crafting you to fulfill His purposes. God is crafting me to fulfill His purposes. And God is crafting us together to fulfill His purposes. In the second chapter of Paul's letter to the Ephesians, we read this: God saved you by His grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so no one can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. We, yes, us, together are God's masterpiece. God will dismantle anything that will try and divide that masterpiece. That is why Paul continues in that same letter, "Don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders. In those days you were living apart from Christ. You were excluded from citizenship among the people of Israel, and you did not know the covenant promises God had made to them. You lived in this world without God and without hope. But now you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to Him through the blood of Christ. For Christ Himself has brought peace to us. He united Jews and Gentiles into one people when, in His own body on the cross, He broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. He did this by ending the system of law with its commandments and regulations. He made peace between Jew and Gentile by creating in Himself one new people from the two groups. Together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of His death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death." Did you hear that? It is by Christ that we can be reconciled between us and God, between us and each other, between us and the world. Where in the world do we find brokenness right now? We already mentioned it. Between us and each other, between us and creation itself, between us and God. In Christ, we can find our hope. And because of what He did on the cross, He reconciled us, and He did that by ending the system of law with its commandments and regulations. God will end any system of law that divides people then and divides people now. That is His job, His mandate, and His kingdom work: to destroy that which seeks to kill, steal, and destroy, that we might be built on the cornerstone of Christ, not built on the history of any nation or nationality, that we would become the temple of God. So what does the future look like? Well, if we abide in Him, I know that the transformation of our being will prepare us for anything that may come our way. I wish I could tell you in detail everything that God has planned for this church. Many people have been sincerely asking, what in the world does church look like for us in the future? And I can tell you this, I don't know. I can tell you that I could craft out some really good ideas, but none of us saw the circumstances that we were in right now 6 months ago. But I can tell you this, a church that is truly church is one that will be faithful to God. A church that is truly church is a people that is faithful to one another. We can continue to move forward out of God's grace, mercy, and love for us. And things are going to look different, but that's okay. God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. But I can tell you this, the gospel will make an impact in our current context. The gospel message has been unchanged from the beginning of time until now. But if the gospel can't land and make an impact on our current context now, it is no gospel at all. The detail of the gospel is that Jesus died on the cross. The effects and the good news is that we get to participate in the new kingdom of peace now. That is unchanging, but what it will look like will be different. But we can trust in the God who never fails to fulfill His promises. My promise to you is that a lead pastor, I will humbly seek the face of God for me and for you. I promise to humbly accept any correction that may come my way. I promise to listen to your concerns. I promise to seek the face of God and listen for His direction. I promise to love you with everything that I have. My hope is that we can all humbly come before our God and ask that He would unite us and move us forward in His power and His strength. Paul wrote a prayer for the Ephesians in chapter 3 that I want to echo for all of us. When I think of all of this, I fall to my knees and pray to the Father, the Creator of everything in heaven and on earth. I pray that from His glorious, unlimited resources, He will empower you with inner strength through His Spirit. Then Christ will make His home in your hearts as you trust in Him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep His love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now all glory to God, who is able through His mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or ever think. Glory to Him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, Ghost.
Thank you for choosing to gather together and worship with us, to receive God's teaching for us and to give Him glory. Please take time to consider these following questions. Who has God made me to be? How does or will my transformed being engage in today's circumstances for the kingdom of God? I'll say that again. How does my transformed being engage in today's circumstances for the kingdom of God? And how would you like to see God move? Discuss those things amongst yourselves and pray. Pray again and pray again. Amen.